Some people have the ability to change their background. Others don't yet. I don't know. I don't claim to know. So how or why these things on the interwebs work. So whatever you have available is what you have available, but it may not be the same as your neighbor. So there you go. All right. Well, today we are continuing to progress in a sermon series that we started at the beginning of 2021 here called Social Undistancing, where we are examining how we can continue to care for and love each other, all those one another's in the scripture, while still remaining physically distant from each other. Although hopefully that will continue to lighten up. I heard a number of folks conversating as we were gathering this morning online about receiving the vaccine. Pastor Kim and others have received it. I'm happy to report that Emily has also received her first dose and just had a little bit of the soreness in the arm and a little bump, but nothing else. So I'm hopeful that I can get on the list here soon, but like I'm sure all of you. So hopefully that will keep rolling in and people will continue to keep receiving the vaccine as quickly as they are available. And I was just talking this last week with our representative from Church Extension, which is the denominational arm that helps us with lending and our building project. And Craig Walls, our representative, confirmed for me or told me that he thinks that our timing is actually really, really good for when the building will be open and the timing of the vaccine and the hopefully scaling down of our social distancing. So I keep praying for that, and I ask you to keep praying for that, that our timing will all fall into place exactly the way it's supposed to be for us to finish up the building, occupy it, and then start making our presence known even more publicly as the pandemic starts to hopefully wind down. I say that knowing it will probably always be here in some shape or form, but maybe we'll be able to gather again in larger groups in person around that same time. So I hope and pray for that. But today I am thankful that we are all able to continue gathering online in this format, something we've gotten used to over the last few months during this pandemic. So this morning we have Pastor Kim on the phone. Pastor Kim, will you start our online gathering this morning with prayer?
Yes, absolutely. As we join this morning, let us be in the spirit of prayer. Infinite love, teach us to contemplate you. For all things speak of you, God. Awaken our praise and thankfulness for every being you have made. Give us grace to feel profoundly joined to everything that is. Lord of love, show us our place as channels of love for all the world. Not one of us escape your merciful eyes. Enlighten those who possess platform, power, or money. Help them not to be indifferent to the plight of the needy. May all of us join together to advance the common good of every child, man, and woman. The poor and the earth are crying out. Seize all of us with your power and light. Help us to bring that light to all of life for the coming of your kingdom of love, justice, peace, and beauty, where none of us hunger and all of us are fed and filled with your presence. We lift before you right now those who are homeless, those who are cold in this bitter weather. Christ, have mercy upon them. We pray an end to this pandemic that has taken so many lives, those that struggle even in this moment. We pray help for the vaccine rollout, Lord. Lord Jesus, for all who suffer this day in any way, bring hope, help, and healing. We ask for strength, Lord, for frontline workers and first responders. Help all caregivers around the world. Rescue, gracious God, those 11 miners in China and bring them to safety. We love you, Lord. Help our love increase as we serve you. As we pray the words, Lord, you taught us to pray, saying it this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thine will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Today, as we prepare for Pastor Joel's message, we read from Romans chapter 10, verses 9 through 21. Your love must be sincere, hate what is evil, and cling to what is good. Love one another with the affection of sisters and brothers. Try to outdo one another in showing respect. Don't grow slack, but be fervent in spirit. The one you serve is Christ. Rejoice in hope. Be patient under trial. Persevere in prayer. Look on the needs of God's holy people as your own. Be generous in offering hospitality. Bless your persecutors. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Have the same attitude toward everyone. Don't be condescending to those who aren't as well off as you. Don't be conceited. Don't repay evil with evil. Be concerned with the highest ideal in the eyes of all people. Do all you can to be at peace with everyone. Don't take revenge. Leave room, my friends, for God's wrath. To quote scripture, vengeance is mine. I will pay them back, says our God. But there is more. If your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them drink. For in doing so, you will heap burning coals upon their heads. Don't be overcome by evil, but overcome evil by doing good. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. If you're following along on harmonysprings.org/virtual-gathering, next up is a song from recorded by Terry Fairfax, Love is the Answer. our thanks to Terry Fairfax and Donnie Thompson for that rendition of Love is the Answer. Yesterday, like many days during this pandemic, I was scrolling through the Facebook feed, my Facebook feed, and saw a longtime friend of mine who posted something to this effect on her social media feed. She posted a link to an article that was written in the Canton Repository just a few days ago about the topic of how Christians can be more prone to believing conspiracies, like some that have become popular over the last year or more, QAnon, etc. And she took offense to the article. As a person of faith, she posted on her feed saying, I'm a Christian, and I think that's generalizing all Christians as being easily gullible, etc., etc. And then she posted that as much as she hates the cancel culture, she was going to cancel her subscription to that newspaper because they ran that particular article. It's an example of, I think, what we've seen transpiring and happening on our social media feeds and in the news and in our lives over the last few years. And I would venture to say even longer than that. Maybe our most recent president has highlighted the divisions in our country and has caused us to embrace that cancel culture in ways we have not before, but our divisions have long been existent, haven't they? In fact, I would say that it's just a part of our humanity to have differences of opinion and differences all around, but there is something as of the last few years and recent in our society, maybe it's the onset of social media and media in general and our choices for what we consume and what we believe because of what we consume. The list goes on and on, but I think there is a truth to acknowledging that we've all had differences in opinion and a variety of differences since the beginning of time, haven't we? In fact, even as one of our own members highlighted not too long ago, the scriptures point out that it happened and was happening even from the very beginning, when there was only two people in the room, Adam and Eve. They couldn't even see eye to eye all the time, could they? Multiply that by however many people are currently in existence, our differences seem to multiply in larger and larger numbers, don't they? The cancel culture, I think, and this idea of calling people out when we disagree with each other is something that has been assigned a name in recent, but it certainly isn't anything new. In fact, in the scripture we read today, the Apostle Paul writes to the church in Rome some wisdom and advice on how to deal with each other when we don't seem to agree with each other on a regular basis. It goes all the way back to Adam and Eve, but it certainly was existent in Jesus's day and soon thereafter, as the Apostle Paul writes some words of wisdom and instruction to the church in Rome. The Apostle Paul points out some characteristics for how we ought to live with one another. That one another phrase in this particular passage in Romans chapter 10 gets repeated over and over and over again. We as human beings have always, it seems, had a difficult time with one another. And especially during this pandemic, we've had to distance ourselves from each other, physically speaking, but we've been distancing ourselves from one another for a while now. And so I think it's important for us to revisit these words of wisdom from the Apostle Paul to the church in Rome and to understand our own humanity and the differences that seem to crop up between us on a regular basis, and ask questions like this: how can we, as people who have committed to live in the way of Jesus, how can we undistance ourselves from one another? It's not easy, is it? In the words of a song that Terry and Tommy just recorded for us, if there were an easy path, we would have found it already, wouldn't we? But there's truth and wisdom in knowing that the hardest things are often the most wise things, and things that are difficult to do, like seeing and understanding each other, are often the most difficult. When we have distance between us, I think it has become easier and easier for us to characterize each other, to generalize each other. And when we aren't sitting across the table from each other, it's easy to do all of those things, to allow our differences to divide us and polarize us, isn't it? When we're just scrolling on a computer and not looking at someone's face sitting across the table, it's easy to read their comments or read their posts or read what they say or the video they've made and immediately react in negative ways. It has become easy, unfortunately, for us to polarize each other, and I would go so far as to say to allow hate for each other to crop up in how we treat each other and one another. Not too long ago, I was reading a New York Times article entitled, "What If Instead of Calling People Out, We Called People In?" It highlights the work of Professor Loretta J. Ross in combating this cancel culture with a popular class that she is teaching at Smith College. In the article in the New York Times, she's quoted as saying, "I think we overuse the word trigger when really we mean discomfort," she said, "and we should be able to have uncomfortable conversations." Being triggered is certainly a popular word these days, isn't it? If there is anything that makes us uncomfortable, instead of living into that uncomfortable and having conversations that may not be pleasant, we can easily turn our backs on each other, especially in this day and age when we are socially distanced from each other and interacting in this internet way. She goes on to say this: maybe what we need to do is call each other in rather than calling each other out. And calling in is similar to calling out, but done privately and with respect. It reminds me of these words in verse 10 that we read today from the Apostle Paul, where the Apostle Paul writes to those that Roman church, "Try to outdo one another in showing respect." I wonder how often in our lives and in the world we do try to take this advice to heart. Try to outdo one another with respect. I don't know about you, but the world I live in, it seems like that is a skill that has been lost in our world. She goes on to say, calling people in is a call out, but done with love. That may mean simply sending someone a private message or even calling them on the telephone, imagine that, to discuss the matter, or simply taking a breath before commenting, screenshotting, or demanding one do better without explaining how. It reminds me of that great Southern phrase that we hear used, bless their heart. In verse 14 of this passage, the Apostle Paul alludes to that and says, bless your persecutors, bless and don't curse them. Although bless your heart may be a phrase that is often used in Southern culture to be a nice way of saying they're off their rocker or they have no idea what they're talking about. But using the word bless reminds us, I think, that even though we may not agree with someone, they are still just as much God's creation and loved by God as we are. Maybe we need to be living into the action of those words, bless each other's hearts more often. The professor referenced in this article spent some time as the program and research director for the Center for Democratic Renewal, which monitored hate groups. And she found herself on a mountaintop in rural Tennessee teaching anti-racism to women whose family were members of the KKK. She thought of what her organization's founder, the Reverend C.T. Vivian, who had been Martin Luther King's field general, told her when she started the job. These words of advice: when you ask people to give up hate, you have to be there for them when they do it. She goes on to expunge and say, expand those words by saying, you can't be responsible for someone else's inability to grow. So take comfort in the fact that you've just offered a new perspective of information, and you did so with love and respect, and then it's okay to walk away. We have a saying in this movement, she writes, some people you can work with and some people you can work around. But the thing that I want to emphasize is that the calling in practice means you always keep a seat at the table for them to come back. My friends at Harmony Springs, we are a part of a long-standing tradition of churches that have always made it our priority to keep a seat at the table for everyone. We can't control what other people do or how they act or behave, but we can always keep a table, a seat at this table, our church's table, for one another, regardless of how much we may disagree. Unity in a time of social distancing, unity in a time of distancing, I think begs us to always keep a chair at the table, open for conversation, or to reopen conversation. In verse 18 here, the Apostle Paul says, do all you can to be at peace with one another. It seems that if we, instead of withdrawing ourselves and being quiet, decide to say our peace in line with the advice of the Apostle Paul and Professor Ross, if we say what we want to say and offer a new perspective of information and then allow God to do what God does and to allow God's Spirit to work in each of us, even with people we may disagree with or even people we may call an enemy, surely God and God's Spirit has the ability to work in each of our lives to bring us to a more full understanding of who we are, who God is, and love for one another. Doing so, I think, is an act that continues to keep a chair open for all of us. For all of us never quite know when we're going to be the one who needs that chair pulled up for us, do we? I've seen a lot of advice that is in line with the Apostle Paul and Professor Ross. Things like just saying your piece and then agreeing to disagree, something we've always done as a part of our church here at Harmony Springs. Say your piece and leave it between them and God, or even so much as writing your comment or response and then just sitting on it and waiting instead of immediately reacting in anger. My friends, I say all of these things and connect all of these things together, both for you and for those who may watch our gathering here, but just as much for you as for me. We're all human, aren't we? And we so often can react in ways that embrace our humanity. But when we walk in the way of love and in the way of Jesus, God continues to call us to be united with each other, even when we may be distant from each other in the myriad of ways that unfortunately we have become distant from each other in this day and time. May we all allow the calling of God in our lives to take a deep breath, to keep the chair open, to say our piece and then walk away, to let God do what God does, all of the above in this day and age. And may we continue to be a church that embraces our diversity, thinking that we are far better off as a group and collective of people if we are united, but not always uniform. We are a church that doesn't expect everyone to believe exactly the same thing, and we think we're better off because of it. In this day and time, it's easy to put those values aside, to forget about those things, and to continue to find ways to reinforce how we are right and other people are wrong. But when we go back to the scriptures and read what the Apostle Paul says, we can be reminded that in this cancel culture, calling people in is always a better long-term strategy than calling people out. Amen and amen.
Amen. Pastor, that message just is more about community, more about coming together, more about us always being one and recognizing the one of humanity. And let us remember the words of Jesus as we move into communion. As he said, on the night that he was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And now we have a word of prayer from Ted Eiler.
Pray with me. Dear God and Father, our Lord Jesus, we come this morning thanking you for bringing us through these troubled waters. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the love you displayed on the night before you would be crucified. You knew that Judas would soon betray you, and yet you initiated this Last Supper as a memorial of your love and forgiveness by using the bread and the wine as the symbolic memorial we were to follow. Your life on earth was always about forgiveness. When the woman was caught in the act of adultery, the crowd wanted to stone her. You, Jesus, simply said, "Let him who is without sin cast the first stone." The crowd soon dispersed, starting with the oldest to the youngest. Turning to the woman, Jesus, you said, "Where are your accusers?" Finally, you said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go your way and sin no more." Even as you were being crucified by being nailed to a cross, you looked at the crowd and said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Friends, the table of the Lord is ready. There is room for all and there is enough for all. I invite you to take your elements, eat and drink together as a church.
Just thank the Lord. just to save his own. Have pity on those whose chances grow thinner. There's no hiding place among the kingdom's throne.
Let us have a word of prayer. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for once again coming to us through this simple meal of bread and juice, for nourishing our bodies and souls, and filling us with hope as we look forward to the eternal banquet. And dear God, I want to use some of the words in Romans 2. We thank you for being an all-loving, faithful, and everlasting God. Your word says that you do not show favoritism because you do not prefer one nation over another. We pray that you renew our minds so that we can reflect your love to all people. I pray that we embrace diversity and do not exclude people because of prejudices we hold in our hearts. Have your divine way in us so we can keep the chairs open for others. Amen.
Amen. On Thursday, I got a text message from Liz Hibbs that a friend of theirs and Green resident was a part of the apartment fire that took place last Thursday, and we immediately sprung into action to be of assistance as a church to her and created a Facebook fundraiser to help her. She had a neighbor who had a grease fire. It wasn't even her fault, but the apartment she lived right above, and she lost everything in that fire along with some other families. So I want to give a big thank you to all the folks who saw that fundraiser on Facebook and shared it and gave to it. We've so far, the last I checked this morning, already raised $2,600 to help her replace things that she lost in the fire and to help her in the days to come as she begins to rebuild. Liz Hibbs is on the phone, and I wanted to give Liz a chance to say a few words about that if you want to, Liz.
So I also would like to tell everyone thank you so much for your generosity and support during this difficult time. I know, you know, Pastor Joel was talking about ways that we can be together even though we're apart, and this is definitely a way that that is happening. And I have to thank everyone at the church, everyone who's donated. Jennifer came over and brought her a card and some money from the church that the church was able to support her with. And I'm so grateful. And I know she's grateful. She was moved to tears. And she told me, she said, you know, when I lost everything, you all showed me that hope and love are not lost. So thank you for that. She, you know, as Joel said, I mean, I didn't realize how bad it was until I saw pictures. And I mean, her whole apartment was just covered in ash. I mean, it's just ash. So this is someone that is a very dear family friend and kind of is like a third grandparent, third unbiological grandparent, obviously, to my kids. And so to see her go through that just breaks my heart. But to see everybody just pouring love out on her and support helps mend it. So thank you.
Thanks, Liz. Appreciate your words and appreciate you taken the initiative to send us a message and let us know about it, and then all the work that you've done to help assist in that fundraising. We're still continuing to collect donations. If you'd like to continue to give to that fund to help Patricia, you can do it on Facebook or on that second page. If you're following along in the gathering guide on our website, there are some links you can give to that fund via Givelify online, or you can send a check marked for Patricia to our PO box if you are in the habit of doing that and would like to support that. We will continue to put those funds together and pass them along to her, as I'm sure she will continue to need them in the month and year to come. So thanks for your quick turnaround on being so generous to help out a person in need who has connections with us here at Harmony Springs. I think it's a good way, the fact that we as a church are able to so quickly turn around and help someone in need who has connections with us here at Harmony Springs. It's a good example, I think, of all that we talked about and have been focusing about today. Love in action, living in the way of Jesus. It's not just words, it's action here at Harmony Springs. It's what we do as a church. It's a text message I sent to Liz when she said, thank you for our support. I simply responded and said, that's what church is, or should be. And Harmony Springs, I'm proud of you and proud to be a part of Harmony Springs for how quickly we answer the call for need in our community. We continue to make progress on our building. Some drywall continues to happen, and we're, I think, just about at the point where the power company is going to come and get us hooked up. We'll keep you updated on that as those things continue to transpire. And we will jump back into helping feed those subcontractors with some goodies and coffee during these winter months. So if you'd like to jump into that and continue to bake those goods or to pick them up and drop them off at the building for those subcontractors, let Debbie McDonald know, and she will put you on the list, and she coordinates that with our project manager who is on site there. Take a look at the announcements this week. There's some leadership meetings coming up. So if you're a part of the church leadership, make sure you got the right date and time. And I will just say this, all the leadership meetings links to Google Meet are the same. So whatever we've been using before, use those same links. They should be correct in the calendar and on that announcements page now. And I saw that Debbie sent out a reminder with for the elders meeting that also had the link. So we'll try to make sure that we're not confusing people by having different links at different meetings and times. So just use that same link anytime we have a leadership meeting, no matter if it's trustees or elders or both. All right. Am I missing anything else? Debbie, Jennifer, Donna?
All right. The book study group did not meet last week because we're going into a new book, I guess. But we will be meeting this week, is my understanding. Anybody else in the group have different information? I believe we are meeting this Thursday with the book that's it's about Buddha and Christ.
Right. Yes.
Not to get the title. It's an old guy thing. Thank you.
You got it. I think that is the plan. But I'll remind Walt to confirm with everybody that that is the case. You got a thumbs up from the Benjamin, so I think that is correct, yes. And Dick, there you go. All right, well, today, like we have the last few weeks, I will leave you with the song that we've all been enjoying that Terry recorded. May you all be blessed this week, and may we all continue to find ways to love each other, even in and amongst our differences. And I hope and pray that we will be together soon in person. Amen and amen.
Let it go, my love, my truest. Let it sail on silver wings. Life's a twinkling, that's for certain, but it's such a fine thing. There's a gathering of spirits, there's a festival of friends, and we'll take up where we left off when we all meet again. I can't explain it, I couldn't if I tried, how the only things we carry are the things we hold inside, like a day in the open, like the love we won't forget, like the laughter that we started, and it hasn't died down yet. Let it go, my love, my truest. Let it sail on silver wings. Life's a twinkling, that's for certain, but it's such a fine thing. There's a gathering of spirits, there's a festival of friends, and we'll take up where we left off when we all meet again. Oh, now didn't we? And don't we make it shine? Aren't we standing in the center of something rare and fine? Some glow like embers, like a light through colored glass. Some give it all in one great flame, throwing kisses as they pass. Let it go, my love, my truest. Let it sail on silver wings. Life's a twinkling, that's for certain, but it's such a fine thing. There's a gathering of spirits, there's a festival of friends, and we'll take up where we left off when we all meet again.
Blessings, everyone. Thanks for logging in and being a part of our gathering this morning. Have a blessed week.
Thanks.
Have a great week. As well. Take care, everyone. Bye.
Love that last song.
Love you.